you stop sharing. Dr. Pranesh Panneerselvam, he was there a minute ago. Dr. Pranesh, can you start your screen share? I will unmute you. I can't find him. Okay, let me see. Dr. Pranesh, I think I'll have to unmute you. Give me a minute, please. Okay, Dr. Pranesh, you are unmuted. I can see your screen.
Yes, sir.
I hope everybody else can see your screen too. Please start talking, sir. Okay, please introduce yourself first.
Yes, sir.
And then you can continue talking. You need to be a little louder.
Okay,
sir. Even during the practice session, your voice was a little soft. So if you can be slightly louder, I think it will be helpful because many people are on earphone as well,
okay.
Mobile devices and all that.
Good evening all. At the outset, I'd like to thank the IMA for this opportunity. I am Associate Consultant at Center of Excellence in Radiology at Ramachandra Medical College. We will see about the imaging findings in COVID-19. So imaging approach will be like which patient to image for the COVID. First, you are suspecting a COVID-19. Imaging is not at all recommended for screening and diagnosis at this point. This was proposed by the ICRI chest radiology subspecialty group in concordance with the AIIMS. So in which there is no imaging recommendation for screening or diagnosis. If COVID test appears to be positive, if at all it's a mild case, we no need imaging there. If there is associated risk factors for developing into a severe disease, then a baseline chest radiography is recommended based on clinical assessment. In a moderate or severe cases, where there is a shortness of breath with respiratory rate more than 24 per minute, or there is a low saturation with hypoxemia, or there is a drop in BP, then you have to do a chest radiography at the baseline for the prognosis as well as for the management. So frequency of repeating a chest radiograph doesn't require like a routine like once in a day or once in 2 days like that. So it depends upon the clinical. If there is a clinical worsening, we need a repeat radiograph there. If there is a clinical improvement, there is no need of any further imaging. So if when there is worsening, we have to take a chest X-ray. If it is not conclusive for the worsening of symptoms, then you have to go for a point of care ultrasound. That is a bedside ultrasound within the isolation ward itself. And for radiography also, you have to have a portable radiograph within the isolation ward as well as in ICU. So that it's not moved out from that location to prevent the infection to the other patients. And CT should be only reserved for the patient who have respiratory complaints, which is unexplained by chest X-ray or point of care ultrasound, or a point of care ultrasound is not at all available for them. So when you are doing a CT chest, appropriate infection control procedures has to be followed for the subsequent patients to be scanned. Otherwise, there will be a transmission of infection. So a CT chest is always reserved when there is a very worsening of symptoms unanswered by the ultrasound as well as X-ray. We'll be seeing the imaging findings of each thing. First is chest radiograph. The typical finding in a coronavirus disease is a peripherally located ground glass opacities. You can see there is a peripheral opacities noted in the mid as well as the lower zone. It has a higher incidence involving the mid and the lower aspect of the lung fields. The upper lobes are usually spare in case of coronavirus diseases, and there won't be any central region involvement. This is a typical classical picture of COVID-19, which shows the peripheral ground glass opacities. With the worsening of symptoms or there is any progression of the disease, you can see that this peripheral opacities can go in for a consolidation. Consolidation, the difference between the peripheral ground glass opacities and the consolidation is you can see linear dark lines within it, which is a air bronchogram noted within the consolidation. And still it is located to the mid and lower zone, and it is peripheral in distribution. And the central region is spare. There are few cases which show a central distribution, which is very less in number. As per present study, there are around, in one of the studies, it was shown only in 60 patients, only 15 have a central type of distribution. But they have associated peripheral distribution also. So for isolated central distribution, it's still like an indeterminate kind. it is not approved for as a imaging finding typical for a coronavirus disease. And one more thing which we see is always a pleural effusion is not at all noticed in this viral pneumonia. But the one thing is, in advanced cases which has went for any worsening of symptoms, we can see a minimal costophrenic angle blunting. That is a minimal synpneumonic type of effusion that was observed even in ultrasound. The findings which are not at all present in COVID, or it is more in, more for a non-COVID criteria, is a moderate to massive type of pleural effusion, or the patient has any lymphadenopathy or pulmonary nodules or cavitation. If these findings are there, it's more likely to be a tuberculosis or any bacterial infection than that of a COVID-19 what we are dealing with. So there are two articles that are published which are a considerable amount of patients. And in this study, they have taken around 64 patients with a chest x-ray shows a sensitivity of detection of 69%, whereas the RT-PCR has sensitivity of only around 91%. Whereas the 31 patients have a normal chest x-ray at presentation who had been positive with RT-PCR. But the one thing is, there are few patients who have a chest x-ray finding which is typical for COVID, but still the RT-PCR is showed negative. So what they did is, they did a repeat RT-PCR after a few days, then they turned out to be positive. So just about the usage of chest x-ray as a preliminary investigation is still not approved. But if you are doing a chest x-ray for any unsuspected cases, even in that, if you are seeing any peripheral opacities, they still recommend to do RT-PCR for that patient, even if the patient is asymptomatic. The chest x-ray findings become worse at around 10 to 12 days of the onset of the disease. The recovery, radiographic recovery is almost parallels that of RT-PCR. This was published by Wong et al. In March 2020. And there is one more paper which was published with 99 patients in the retrospective review. They have shown that all the patients have progressed to consolidation from ground glass opacities, where most of it are bilateral in presentation. Still, they show unilateral presentation can be there in COVID. Unilateral doesn't rule out COVID, but almost all the patients shows a mid and lower predominance and peripheral distribution. A pneumothorax was seen in one of the patients which had a smoking history as well as the emphysematous blurb associated with it. Follow-up is chest x-ray is always recommended for the any worsening of the disease. So this is a standard reporting format which was proposed by AIIMS as well as Narayana Hospital in Bangalore. They have given like listed the findings which are for COVID and not for COVID also. That is, one is the ground glass opacities and consolidation. These are typical for a coronavirus disease, whereas cavity, nodules and lymphadenopathy, as well as the moderate or massive pleural effusion, it is not in favor for a coronavirus disease. So in these cases, you have to mention whether these findings are present or absent, and you have to mention which zone of the lung is affected, which is very, very essential for the follow-up. So you have to mention which part of the lung is affected, and you have to mention whether there is any underlying disease also. Either it can be seen in the present imaging itself, or there is any old imaging associated with the patient where you can detect any older findings there. You have to mention that also. And the impression has to be given on the severity. The severity is graded upon the percentage of lung involvement, in which up to 25% is considered score 1, and if there is 50% of the lung is involved, score 2. You have to grade it for each side, and you have to add together. If it is one on right upper zone, one on left upper zone, then you have to combine it together, and the total score will be 2. So that will come under moderate. So this is mainly proposed to for an easy follow-up in the ICU setting. If this is for a patient who is a known COVID positive, if it is a COVID suspect, then you have to add 4 lines at the end of the report, whether it is normal. Even if the chest x-ray finding is normal, COVID is not excluded, because it takes time for the chest x-ray to develop the show findings. And for a classic, or either you have to mention it as a classic or probable COVID, or an indeterminate for COVID. Classic is they have to have ground glass opacities, and it should be peripheral distribution and lower lobe predominant. These 3 findings have to be there for a classic COVID. And for an indeterminate, if they does not fit in for any classic or probable COVID criteria, but they are having consolidation which has both central and peripheral, still the COVID has to be considered as a diagnosis to prevent the transmission of infection. So needs to be tested further. And you have to look for lymphopenia and all in these cases. A non-COVID criteria, if there is any lobar predominance of pneumonia, if it is not diffuse and bilateral only to a particular lobe, that is more than for a bacterial pneumonia. That is not in a case of a viral pneumonia. If there is any pleural effusion, pulmonary edema or pneumothorax, that's also considered as a non-COVID criteria. This was recommended by the British Society of Thoracic Imaging. Next, we go on to the ultrasound, which is a point of care ultrasound, what we do in the bedside. So we follow blue protocol. It's a bedside lung ultrasound in emergency. We prefer to use a low frequency transducer for the adequate depth perception, because the patients may vary. Some may be obese, some may be thin. So better we have a low frequency so we can manage for both the patients. And a curvilinear probe is used. You can use a linear high frequency probe or a phased array probe, but always have a separate portable ultrasound for isolation ward or ICU. And you fix to one probe. If you all are comfortable with the curvilinear probe, have that probe alone. All these things are to be avoid the infection. And you should always wear a probe cover before you do an ultrasound. And the machine has to be sterilized even if it's within the isolation ward. In this blue protocol, we have to... We have to divide the chest surface into six quadrants. For that, we have to draw a parasternal line, an anterior axillary line, as well as posterior axillary line. In this, we have to divide it into superior and inferior. So this is called as the right anterior superior quadrant, right antero inferior, like that, right lateral superior, or right lateral inferior. Similar to that, you have a posterior quadrants also in the lung. This is posterior superior and inferior. So six on each side, there will be 12 quadrants you have to image while you do a point of care ultrasound. And the imaging pattern should be in a zigzag way. Should start like this and go like a S-shaped pattern, like a Z. We have to scan the lung both in coronal as well as in sagittal plane in at each rib space. That's what you have to do in case of a point of care ultrasound when you are looking for a lung finding. And the findings, what you see is there are three lines you should know before you go in for a lung ultrasound. One is a A line. A line is a horizontal line. Horizontal lines, these are seen even in normal patients or in cases of pneumothorax. To differentiate between a normal and pneumothorax, here the lung will be sliding, here the lung won't be sliding. The lung sliding is seen at the pleural line. This is the pleural line, which is very irregular. And there can be one to three vertical lines that is normal for one field. If it is more than three vertical lines, that is, vertical lines are called as the B lines, that will obscure the normal A lines when it appears. If it's more than three B lines, it's considered some fluid is getting into the lung. That corresponds to a ground glass opacity in an X-ray or a CT chest. So more than three or three to seven, more than seven, it's considered as the worsening severity of a pneumonia. Here you can see that there is a more than five lines. More than five lines you are seeing here, which is very fine. This is quite like a early kind of ground glass opacity. If these lines are getting thicker and confluent as you've seen here, and you can see a horizontal pleural line here separately, but this thing is not very obvious here. It is merged with the underlying confluent B line. This is a feature of a severe type of pneumonia going in for a ARDS. And when there is a consolidation, you will always have the C type of line. C line is nothing but the similar B line feature will be there, but there will be an irregular pleural line. And there can be a subpleural hypoechogenicity, that is a low echogenicity. This is called the shredded lung parenchyma. This shows that the lung is going in for a consolidation. So within in this blue protocol, first you have to look for a lung sliding. If the lung sliding is absent and there are multiple A lines, too many A lines are present, you have to consider, there are too many horizontal A lines are present, you have to consider it as a pneumothorax. If the lung sliding is present but still have patient having breathlessness, but there are no vertical B lines, then you have to do a DVT analysis to rule out pulmonary thromboembolism. With a DVT, for a DVT, you have to do a venous Doppler of the lower limb. And if the lung sliding is normally present, but the patient is having too much of B lines, that is a vertical B lines are there, then you have to go in for the assessment of B lines, whether it is multiple in number, what is the thickness of the B line and the intervening distance. If there are more than three B lines with the irregular pleural line or a subcortical subpleural consolidation is there, then you should think of a pneumonia. If it is going in for a confluent B line as you see here, with the pleural line is not clearly seen, then it is in favor for a pulmonary edema. If these findings are not there, but you are seeing a normal sliding lung, still the DVT analysis is also negative. There is no DVT in the vein. D-dimer is negative. then you have to look for any bacterial type of consolidation. For that, you have to go for the scanning of the Plaps point. Plaps point is nothing but you have to scan the inferior most aspect of the lung, where you can see the liver parenchyma, the diaphragm, as well as the lung parenchyma. Here, it's this location is a more commonest location for a pneumonic type of consolidation with a minimal pleural effusion. If these things are absent, then you have to evaluate for a COPD or asthma. So this is a finding which is seen in a COVID patient. You can see these B lines are very thick. This is not thin B lines. With the advancement of the disease, it went to a confluent type of B lines. You can't see any discrete B lines. And with the worsening of the disease, this pleural line become irregular. This shows the stage of progression of the parenchymal disease. So for a lung ultrasound, whoever reports it, better it is like either have a radiologist which is in-house for an isolation ward at ICU, or to better to train the intensivist in the ultrasound to do how to do a lung ultrasound. And these images can be pushed to PACS and can be concurrently seen by the radiologist also. So always is that as you do an X-ray, you have to mention the description for each quadrant, what you have done for all the 12 quadrants. And this was proposed by James Rippey, which shows that the severity of the B lines, they have proposed it. And this is followed worldwide by British as well as the American peoples. It's a B plus or B2 plus or B3 plus. It's depends on the number of B lines per rib space. If it is 3 to 7, more than 7 or confluent, that depends upon the severity of the pneumonia. Any one particular quadrant going in for B3 plus, it is considered as a severe disease. Like that, and do for a consolidation also, whether you are seeing an irregular pleurine or you are seeing this subpleural type of hypercogenicity, which is a consolidation less than 1 centimeter, it is a moderate kind of disease. If it is a larger area of consolidation, it's a severe kind of disease. This is how a lung ultrasound reporting is done. Coming to the CT, the recently there is a Fleischner Society consensus which was obtained for which patient the CT is indicated. Now they are in a thing that the CT should be avoided to prevent the spread of infection. So the chest X-ray is always preferred, and in concurrence with the ultrasound, if those findings are not in favor of clinical finding which shows a respiratory worsening, the patient is worsening clinically but the chest X-ray and ultrasound are not showing any progress of disease, then the CT is indicated at that point. Or if there is any functional impairment or hypoxemia after the patient has recovered from COVID-19, then the CT is indicated in those patients. But on another situation, what we all face is if they do a CT for abdomen or a neck, better to include part of the chest in the either CT abdomen or neck. And in those lower zones, if you are lower, I mean the lower lobes, if you are seeing any features which are typical for a coronavirus disease, that is the ground glass opacities, or a suspicious for a COVID, better we advise RT-PCR for those patients so we can prevent the spread of these infections. So this is the early finding, what do you see in a COVID, that is a peripheral rounded type of ground glass opacities, which is confined to the lower lobes of the lung. So this rounded type of ground glass opacities is almost like it's more specific for a COVID-19. As one more thing is these peripheral type of ground glass opacities, which are confluent and extending along the subpleural region at the early stage itself, it is seen in a swine flu, it is a H1N1 pneumonia that also shows the ground glass type of opacities. With the progression of the disease, you can see these ground glass opacities becomes confluent with time. It goes throughout the periphery of the lung, and then it goes in for a consolidation. There's multiple air bronchogram and consolidation. And at the early stage, it will be more peripheral in locate distribution. With the progression of the disease, it go in for more central type of distribution of the disease. And this is one more pattern. What is seen in coronavirus disease is that underlying the ground glass opacity, that is in the background of ground glass opacity, you can see this interlobular septal thickening. This is called as the crazy paving pattern or organizing pneumonia pattern. These things are very typically seen in the COVID in the peripheral as well as lower lobar distribution. So based on the British Society of Thoracic Imaging, they told that the 100% confidence for a COVID or a classic COVID is the lower lobe peripheral predominant foci of ground glass opacity should be there. So ground glass opacity is a dictum. Additional to that, there can be a crazy paving peripheral consolidation or a reverse halo. I'll show you the reverse halo, how it will be. And the probable COVID is like there is no ground glass opacity, but there is a lower lobe predominant with peripheral consolidation or a bronchocentric type of consolidation. with a minimal ground glass opacity. Scarce ground glass opacity is what we see in dependent part of the lung is there. We have to consider still that as a probable COVID needs a RT-PCR. Indeterminate patients are the ones who show that does not fit into any of the criteria of probable COVID, but they have any pre-existing lung disease. That is already a connective tissue disorder patient having a features of ILD, which is a ground glass opacity. But still, there is no feature, clinical feature of a COVID, which suggests an alternate diagnosis. But still, we have to confirm whether it is a COVID or not. So better we do a RT-PCR for those patients, even if it's asymptomatic, when there is a ground glass opacities. Non-COVID criteria are those what you have seen already, that is the cavitations, nodularities, lymphadenopathy, as well as the lobar predominance of pneumonia. So this is a crazy paving pattern. They're showing multiple interlobular septal thickening in the background of ground glass opacities, which can progress to areas of consolidation. This is a feature for a classic COVID. And this is one is a reverse halo sign, which is also a feature of organizing pneumonia that is seen in COVID patients. That is also peripheral in distribution, which shows a central type of ground glass opacities with peripheral rounded type of consolidation. Another probable COVID is like a bronchocentric. Even if the peripheral opacities are there, there are multiple central opacities also there. So better we rule out COVID in these patients also. Pre-COVID criteria, we won't think of viral pneumonia in these kind of patients. As the widespread advance of the disease, they recommend to rule out COVID if even if this presentation is like that. So this is a kind of indeterminate for COVID. There is a minimal ground glass opacity only in the dependent aspect of the lung. This we quite see if you do a 10 CT chest, there may be two CT chests who shows a dependent type of ground glass opacities. But if there is associated fever or lymphopenia in those patients, then you do RT-PCR even for a scarce type of ground glass opacities. This granular appearance of the lung parenchyma is always seen in case of bacterial diseases. So this is more in favor for a non-COVID. To confirm this, always do a MIP, that is the maximum intensity projection, MIP reconstruction of the lung window, which shows multiple small nodules. This nodular appearance, this small nodular appearance is more for a bacterial pneumonia. This is not in favor for a coronavirus disease. You can consider this as a COVID negative type of disease. Thank you.